دع الأيام تفعل ما تشاء وطب نفسا إذا حكم القضاء ولا تجزع لحادثة الليالي فما لحوادث الدنيا بقاء وكن رجلا على.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، ما بعد. I am very, very honored to be a part of, inshallah ta'ala, what promises to be a very interesting conversation and some gems of wisdom with all of my peers and colleagues that are on this call. We have, alhamdulillah, Sheikh Yasir Birjas, who is a dear friend of mine. We studied together in Medina, even though he was senior to me. And he is, of course, the Imam of Valley Ranch Masjid. We have, of course, our own Ustad Nadeem Bashir. We have Sheikh Umar Sulaiman, who again needs no introduction, also Valley Ranch Masjid. And we have Sheikh Abdullah Uduro, the Imam of ICC. And we decided to have a conversation in light of the fact that tomorrow is going to be the beginning of the new Islamic calendar. 1,442 years have gone by since the Hijrah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because of the COVID crisis, we do not have live lectures in the masajid. So we thought, let's all come together and let's just benefit each other and inshallah ta'ala remind each other of some of the benefits of this auspicious occasion. So I want to begin inshallah ta'ala with Sheikh Abdullah Uduro. Sheikh Abdullah, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Alhamdulillah. So jazakallah for coming on our call, Sheikhana. The hijrah tomorrow, you have any comments, any nasiha, any advice for us?
Bismillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala amma ba'd. Firstly, alhamdulillah, I'm pleased to be here to remind myself and all of you of this event. Not particularly to make it a certain time that we celebrate on this day, but more importantly, as we do within learning the seerah and learning the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, taking the journey throughout the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see many incidents that took place, or many snippets or trailers, if you will, within his whole life. That's important for us to reflect on how we act or how we plan to act, or learning how to act according to the situation and circumstances. When we see the hijrah, many of us know the hijrah of migrating from one state to another, migrating from Mecca to Al-Madinah. But when we see the hijrah of migration, it's very important for us to understand that the struggle of the migration of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we see with Tufayl ibn Amr ad-Dawsi, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhum, Abu Huraira, Abu Dharr, all of these companions, that they struggled to make the migration from Mecca to Al-Madinah, some of them, most of them. Understanding the meaning of this migration, as subhanAllah Ibn Qayyim graciously puts it in Risala Tabukiya, how he, in the letter to the people of Tabuk, when he was writing in answer to one of his ikhwan, his brothers in Tabuk, when he mentioned that the hijrah, hijratan, that the migration is two types of migrations. The first is that of which we know now and which we're talking about, but I don't want to talk about that, because many of us may look at the historical context, which is great, but that should only be an introduction and a prelude to what are you going to do about that in your life? Why does it matter? And that's the beautiful thing about the Sharia, which I want to touch upon, is how any incident or thing that takes place, we see within the A'yad, within the celebrations of the conclusion of Ramadan, the conclusion of Hajj, and even within the hijrah that we see, it is all a manifestation of showing gratitude and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and trusting in Allah depending on the circumstance, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having mindfulness of Him throughout our whole situation. So when we're talking about state to state, we're not talking about, you know, as people say now, from California or New York to Dallas. You know, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the state of your heart, migrating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the state of your heart? You know, those of us that have converted to Islam, or those of us that were born Muslim and, you know, had an epiphany and decided to start praying. That's what I'm talking about. when you see this migration from the with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Mecca to Al-Madinah, and he was of the last of them to migrate, and he's with Umar ibn Khattab, or he's with Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Abu Bakr was afraid, and the mushrikun, the polytheists were right above them and could see them, because they decided to try to take his life sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did he tell them? La tahzan, inna Allaha ma'ana. Do not have any fear. Don't be sad, for verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. So that's what we want to talk about. I want to talk about here is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even mentions in the chapter of Adh-Dhariyat, fafirru ila Allah, and run to Allah. One thing that's important for us to know is when we run to something, we're running from something. So that migration to Allah is running from what Allah has predestined for you. As we say, wa'udhu bika mink in our dua, and I seek refuge in you from you. So this is a manifestation of the first pillar of Islam, which is our trust in Allah, our love in Allah, our reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we see that with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah, when we see the father of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Ibn Quhafa, who was an older gentleman that used to mock the deen of Islam, but later became Muslim. What about you? What have we made figurative hijrah from? Those friends, those people online. What are those things that we are leaving to go towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that's the beauty of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he says, "A'udhu bika mink, wa'udhu bika mink." You know, when he seeks refuge from Allah to Allah, understanding that what Allah has predestined, as such as the 13 years in Mecca, they left from that, and their hearts were conditioned, trusting in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make that move, and leaving off everything, as they mentioned, all we had was Allah and His Messenger. So when you look at this hijrah, and you read with your families, inshallah, about this migration, you look at Salama and her struggle, and I always look at that as a romantic story. You know, you see the struggle that they made. It started, as Ibn al-Qayyim mentions, that the hijratul abdan, lazim, it has to be with the hijratul qalb, before the hijratul abdan, the migration of the bodies. A condition for that migration is the migration of the heart. Now that we are here with COVID and we are in our homes and some of us are out, what migration that we sit and we've literally learned ourselves, learned our families to make that spiritual migration within ourselves, because that is the most important. And that is what the companions had well within themselves and their hearts, migrating from that state in their hearts, from polytheism, from worshiping idols, from tribalism, from even race. Some of them, there were some elements of racism, seeing that and migrating to the oneness of Allah, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone is equal. And with that, going to Al-Madinah with that state in their hearts. So looking at our hearts and seeing what migration have we made. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of the muhajirin, lughatan wa istilahan.
Beautiful. So a beautiful reminder about the hijrah is a perpetual journey of the heart, always wanting to flee away from what Allah has forbidden towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's not just one incident, but rather that sets the stage for the spiritual hijrah. Sometimes people ask me, like, what is from the stories of the hijrah, which incident or which aspect do I find the most, if you like, appealing? And that's a difficult question, because everything is very, very beautiful in the seerah. But one aspect that I find especially pertinent when you look at the incidents of the seerah is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told by Allah that he's going to migrate somewhere, but he wasn't told where. And he was waiting for the sign from Allah to migrate. And a dream came to him, and the dream showed him Yathrib or Medina. It showed him the land, but it didn't have a title on it. And Allah Azza wa Jalla sent him multiple dreams. The first dream did not have the name of the city. The second, third, fourth dream, we don't know exactly what dream, but eventually the city's name was revealed. So the Prophet later on was telling the Sahaba about this, and he said, I saw the land of the Hijrah, and it was a land of date palms, a fertile green land. And the name was not given to him. So he said, my heart, my imagination went to Yemen. And then it turned out to be Medina. And Medina is better for us if they only knew. Now, what I find interesting here is that when the Prophet ﷺ saw the dream, and he wasn't told exactly which city it was, his heart went to Yemen. Why? Why Yemen? Why did he envision or imagine or aspire to Yemen, which was so far away? It was because Yemen was known for its strength, its power, its stability. It was known for its righteous people, because the Prophet praised the people of Yemen in numerous hadith. In other words, when our Prophet ﷺ was looking for a stable land to migrate to, he looked to a land that was already politically established. Out of all of the provinces of Arabia, out of all of the lands of Arabia, Yemen was the most established. Yemen was the most advanced. It had a kingdom for so many centuries. And so what we learn from this actually is very interesting. And that is that we learn here wisdom and acumen. We learn here that the Muslim, the mu'min, is not a fool. He's a wise person. The mu'min looks at all opportunities. Not every opportunity is the same. And if you're given the choice, you choose the one that is the most stable, or the most conducive, or the most powerful, or whichever one will be the best for your solution. So when options were open, the Prophet ﷺ opted. He desired that it be Yemen. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla said to him, no, it's actually Medina. And once Allah's decision came, he said, Medina is going to be better for us. Okay, whatever was my desire, that's secondary. Allah's choice is better. So once the decree comes and the doors are shut, then we accept the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a beautiful point that I benefited from the incidents of the stories of the seerah. So I want to move on to Sheikh Yasir Birjas. Can you share with us as well, Sheikhina, some incidents that you have from the seerah, especially from the hijrah, and how we can benefit during this time frame?
Absolutely. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam wa taslimin kathira thumma amma ba'd. Subhanallah, if anything we learn from this experience with the COVID-19 and the circumstances many people going through today, is that it really exposed people and realized how unprepared we are in our life, unfortunately. As a matter of fact, it's basically kind of like we can't even begin to start about how unprepared we are in terms of our provision, our planning, our goals, our dreams, the efforts we're putting, where we're putting our energy in. And really, this experience is kind of teaching us the importance of being ready and being prepared. Also, it exposes the misunderstanding of the meaning of having tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, relying on Allah azza wa jal, and putting our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without having really proper tawakkul or proper preparation for that. So what I really see from the hijrah is one of the main aspects of the hijrah, how the Prophet ﷺ taught us that the balance between having a trust in Allah Azza wa Jalla and also taking all the possible means, or asbab as we call them, in order to make your goals come true and make them happen. So I have a few things from the seerah, from incidents from the seerah, that actually bring that to us, inshallah. Number one, the importance of companionship. Nowadays, in the COVID-19, a lot of people, they realize, subhanAllah, how much I'm attached to having social life, right? You know, we live in the culture of extreme and radical individualism, self-centric culture. It's all about, you know, me and me, and everything revolves around me. You can see that manifested in the social media, among the young couples, among young people in particular. But this COVID-19 thing, you know, realize that, you know what, living alone is not sufficient. It's not going to be fun. When you are able to go out and so on, there's not preparation for that. So now people, they realize, you know what, I need companionship. And just to let you know, Sheikh, for the past few months, I've done a lot of, alhamdulillah, nikahs, and also done a lot of marriage contracts, because people realize, you know what, I need to get married. I need companionship. So Hijrah is teaching us that companionship is important. When the Prophet ﷺ went to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and he kept telling him, wait. Abu Bakr says, I want to travel. I want to take my opportunity and travel. And the Prophet told him, wait. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a companion. And eventually he came to him and told him the companionship just happened right now. The second thing we see in terms of preparation really for in the hijrah, as we should be preparing ourselves and our lives, is prepare the ride for it, the journey. See, a lot of people, they don't understand life is a journey in itself. And if you don't have a proper ride for it, you're not going to be able to cross, you know, through the terrain of this life. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was visionary, and that's what it means. You need to be visionary. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, he knew that if the possibility is the Prophet is asking him to wait until he has a companion, he might be the one. So what did he do, radiallahu anhu? He prepared that by purchasing and paying for two camels and got them ready for the journey. You need to be visionary. You need to take opportunities. You need to also have trust in power. Maybe it might materialize. like basically put that trust in that fashion. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the privilege and the honor to be the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr Siddiq and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another thing we learn from the Prophet being preparing for the hijrah is actually privacy. What does that mean? We could call it secrecy, but we call it here privacy. Today we live in a life, no one is leaving anything private, you know, for themselves. Everything is on online. Whether you have a birthday, your birthday came around, you switch jobs, you did this, you do that, you're making this project or that project. We're exposing all our affairs out there to the public, to everybody out there. And part of the sunnah is just keep something private for yourself. And one of these major things when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tried his best to stay private, obviously, not mention anything even to his closest friend, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So he went, you know, at that time, al-dahira, during the heat of the sun, when not so many people out there, taking a different route to the house of Abu Bakr Siddiq, and he got in there, covering his face, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of that, trying his best to keep that matter extremely, extremely private, because the result of it is very important to keep it that way. So as a suggestion for many people of our time right now, keep your life private as much as you can, and you don't have to expose yourself, you know, in many, many ways that may lead to disappointment and make poor choices in the future as a result of that. We also learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's hijrah also the importance of having provision. You know, you cannot just make that journey without having provision. And here Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr Siddiq, they prepared Asma bint Abu Bakr Siddiq to carry that provision for them when they were hiding in the cave of Thawr for some time. In addition to that, also one thing we learned from the preparation the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in the hijrah is actually collecting intelligence, you could say. Nowadays, we could call it, you know, investigation, being thorough in your seeking knowledge and, you know, investigating what you need to do in the future. And here the Prophet ﷺ was actually also utilizing the knowledge and the expertise of Abdullah ibn Bakr Siddiq, a young man, who would go around in Mecca collecting the news for the Prophet ﷺ, like investigating on their behalf and bringing them the information they need to make a very important decision in their life. There is much more we could really learn from this. And finally, the expertise of the guide the Prophet ﷺ took with them in order to guide them to the desert. We always need that coach and that expert who can help us through our journey into this life. So the hijrah has so many lessons, but definitely being prepared for life, especially in time like ours, is one of the most important things people should prepare for, inshallah ta'ala. Wallahu a'lam.
MashaAllah, Zakallah khair, beautiful logistical lessons from the hijrah about our own journey to life, that we don't just wander into the desert, lots of precautions and planning, and the meticulous care that the Prophet undertook before he did the journey of the hijrah. Sheikh Umar Suleiman, MashaAllah, we're happy to have you on this call as well. Sheikh, if you can benefit us with your wisdom and gems about the hijrah and some lessons from the hijrah for us.
Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi as-sami'i minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wa la 'udwana illa 'alal zalimin wal 'aqibatu lil muttaqin. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik 'ala 'abdika wa rasulika Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa 'ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman katheera. It's wonderful to be here, alhamdulillah, with all of the beautiful faces and scholars that give so much to our community. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always keep our hearts united and allow us to collectively build this community in Dallas and the Metroplex, as well as bidhna Allah ta'ala throughout the country, and inshallah ta'ala inspire more unity and coming together throughout the world. Allahumma ameen. I wanted to actually share my reflections on that note of community and institution and what that reflects, what it means when you look at the hijrah from the standpoint of communication and from the standpoint of unity and from the standpoint of having something to reminisce on. And it's more of a reflection. I want us to just first and foremost appreciate that 10 years is not a very long time. The time that the Muslims spent together where Medina was established to the end of the Prophet's life is not a very long time. I mean, some of us can remember our last 10 years as if they were yesterday, right? You know, you've been with the community for, I think Sheikh Yasser Burgess has probably been with Valley Ranch, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, probably for about a decade now, if not the whole decade past, mashallah, tabarakallah. So, you know, I'm the newbie in Valley Ranch. I came 8 or 9 years ago. So the point is that 10 years, a decade is really not a long time to have the formation of a community, especially when so much is going on, right? If you think about how quickly the last 6 months have passed because of the COVID era. What is the era of Badr and the era of Uhud and the era of Khandaq and the era of battle after battle and then Fatih and then Hudaybiyah and then Fatih and all of the things that are developing, the first Hajj and then the farewell Hajj, all the things that are in constant development. So for such a short period of time, there's a lot going on in the community of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, there is a beauty, a particular beauty to the hijrah of the community building its place of worship. You see, in Mecca, it is purifying the place of worship. It's purifying the Kaaba of the idols that have been placed within it and the innovated practices, both in terms of worship and in terms of what came out of worship. That's one thing, that's purifying it. But in Medina, you're starting from scratch, right? These Sahaba, including the Prophet ﷺ, literally carried the bricks and they built that masjid and they built that community. They fought off enemies from within and enemies from without. They fought off the largest army in the history of the Arabs in Khandaq, and that is a formative experience for them. They witnessed the sweetness of the victory of Badr and the confidence that came with that. They witnessed the wailing of Uhud. There's a lot that they went through. Right? And I want us to just appreciate for a moment, and I think the best way to do that, one of the things about the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would reminisce on their time with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and many of the tabi'een, to them, the Sahaba were these legends, and even though some of them were alive in their midst, especially the young ones, the youth, a Sahabi could pass right by them that they would have heard about and spoken about, and they wouldn't recognize that Sahabi because that Sahabi would keep such a low profile. Hence, you find the instance like that of Salman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and a man thinking he's just some average man, Salman al-Farisi radiallahu anhu, who embraced Islam in the Baqi' with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the first to embrace Islam in Medina. And someone just thinks he's just someone to carry the groceries for him, right? Hey, Salman, come here. Hey, he doesn't know his name. Come here. Can you help me out with these, right? And because of the interest of the companions to keep a low profile, they would not make it a point to make themselves known to some of these tabi'een. And I just thought of this idea that imagine, one of those companions meeting a young man named after him, right? Because the Sahaba lived long enough, many of them lived long enough to see tabi'een named after them, right? And realize that they're named after them, but that kid has no idea that he's looking at the person he was named after. There is a beauty to beginnings. And alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, as communities, Dallas in particular has been a rapidly forming community, and we've all seen the beginnings of these masajid, and Sheikh Yasir Qadhi, you've seen alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, you've been with the community now in Epic, through the beginnings of the COVID era and the versatility and the adjustments that will never leave us, because of what's happened in the COVID era. And all of us will have something to look back on, inshallah ta'ala. And anytime we start to feel disunity, anytime we start to feel our hearts coming apart, one of the best remedies for disunity is to sit down and reminisce. Remember when we had just started out, remember when this was happening, remember how we came together here, remember how we came together there, and we were productive and we started this effort with so many dreams. Well, look at where it's at now. Do we really want to lose that and compromise it? And so I think the beauty of the Hijri calendar is that we can always look back to the origins of this community being built and say, let's not lose sight of how precious this mission is, and how silly some of the things that cause the mission to be lost can be sometimes. There are serious disagreements and there are things that need to be had out sometimes, but the amana of keeping this community together, the way that the Prophet ﷺ and his companions put those bricks together and reminiscing on that together and reminiscing on our own time together. If Sheikh Yasir Bajas ever wants to beat me up, I can remind him of when he asked me to move to Valley Ranch. I can tell him, Sheikh, you told me you wanted me to come here. Now you're trying to throw me out. What's going on here? I could remind him of that, of those moments. I'm not even fighting. If Sheikh Abdullah Duro wants to fight, I'm just saying, tupt in Islam. I'm not even fighting Sheikh Abdullah Duro. I'll call my brother-in-law to the fight and I'm done. You win, Sheikh Abdullah. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep our hearts together and allow us to remember our precious beginnings and allow us to maintain our precious unity. Allahumma ameen.
Inshallah. Sheikh Omar, honestly, that was a very, very profound message. And as you were speaking, so many riwayat and athar were coming into my mind of the Sahaba reminiscing. وَلَقَدْ رَأَيْتُنَا. And I remember a time when I was the seventh of the seven converts. I remember a time when so and such and such happened. I remember a time in the valley of the Sha'ba, the Bani Hashim, when we had nothing to eat except such and such. So many of the Sahaba reminisced of those times so that they could remind others of the difficulties they had been through and so that they could contextualize. So that's a very profound point, that the Hijrah always brings us back to one of the most dangerous times where the Prophet and Abu Bakr were fleeing basically from the Quraysh and putting their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this began over there. So beautiful reminder of for every one of us to go back to those critical points individually in our marriage, with our families, with our communities, to remind ourselves of the struggles that we've faced so that inshallah ta'ala we can use those struggles to look at the broader picture. Very, very wise point. Imam Adim, mashallah, our own local imam here, mashallah, can you believe because of the COVID crisis, he's in his office, I'm over here. We have to be separated because of social distancing. So we're in the same building, but not quite in the same room. But Imam Nadeem, the floor is all yours, alhamdulillah.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'een. First of all, I want to thank all of our guests, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us during these difficult times. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us and our families, amin rabbil alameen. Subhanallah, Sheikh Yasir Bejaz earlier was talking about something that really got me thinking about, subhanAllah, the fact that when the Prophet was making this hijrah and this migration, the fact that you have the son of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala gathering intelligence around Makkah, hearing the people, gathering information exactly what they're talking about. You have Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anha, that she's tearing her cloth and she's trying to facilitate for her father and for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the one thing that really got me thinking is that, in such an auspicious moment in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we see the involvement of the youth of their community. And, this is one thing that I really think that we really need to keep on pushing forward, which is our youth involvement in all of our communities, whether it's a masjid, whether it's an Islamic organization. We need to start bringing together our youth. And subhanAllah, our youth are so talented. They're so smart. They're so intelligent. And yet a lot of times we see that, they're given, small tasks that even they feel at times that they are belittled. And, subhanAllah, we're talking about at that time, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu does not need to train his son so much so. He's telling his son, go and gather intelligence. Now, he is smart enough at that age to go, and he knows who to talk to. You don't want to seem too obvious. You don't want to seem, too secretive either. He is so smart that his father just tells him, go and gather intelligence. And he's already trained enough to know how to do such a very big job that today, I think, probably no one of our youth can do a job of that type. I'm not trying to belittle our youth. I'm saying that we need to really bring together our youth. And, we really have to empower them, give them responsibilities. SubhanAllah, one of the things that we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life is that even when our youth, they make mistakes, we have to learn how to just let them go, teach them, educate them, give them another opportunity. We all know about Usama ibn Zayd radiallahu ta'ala an, when the very famous story when there was an expedition that came back to Medina, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was informed that Usama ibn Zayd took the life of one person, despite the fact that he was saying la ilaha illallah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very famously, we know that he said to him, hal shaqaqta qalba, like, did you open up his heart and check whether he was saying la ilaha illallah with sincerity or not? But yet, despite that, we find that at the end of the life, his own life, he assigned Usama ibn Zayd to be the lead of the entire expedition. So one thing when it comes to our youth is empowering our youth, giving them big responsibilities. Of course, they will probably make mistakes, but then that is where we need to constantly guide them. The second incident I want to quickly refer to from the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the incident of Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, which Sheikh Abdullah Aduro, he had earlier referenced. And, you know, the one thing about Umm Salama's story is that we learned that Umm Salama, she had left Mecca with her husband and her child. And at the end of the day, she was separated from her child and from her husband. And she's all by herself. Now, I want you, I mean, everyone, if you just think about this, a mother being disconnected from her baby. And it was not just a day. It was not 2 days. Some books of history, some books of Sirah mentioned it was several months. In fact, some books of Sirah mentioned it was probably an entire year. Now, think about this and connect that with our current situation with COVID, where we are separated from everyone else. We cannot be around our loved ones. We are like, we're disconnected from everyone. At that most important time, at one of the most difficult times in the life of Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha, she resorted to dua. And I think that a lot of times what happens is that we make dua, and after a while we feel like that our dua is not working. Our dua is not effective. And I think that we really take from that story of Umm Salama radiallahu ta'ala anha during her hijrah, that you have to constantly put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our job is to make dua to Allah. It's Allah's decision when He wants to accept that dua. And so that's one, that's another lesson. And lastly, for anyone, this, you know, this Hijri, this, the new year that we began from a historical point of view, you know, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he comes to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he's saying that we need some structure when it comes to dates. Before that, it was always about a year. This year, this happened, this year, this happened. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he made a decision in a way that will make life easier for the Muslims. Okay, he made life easier for the Muslims. And eventually, he made mashura with everyone. And he decided to start off with, he started off the Islamic calendar with the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why, hence, every year we, you know, every single year it's 1441 after hijrah, 1442 after hijrah, and so forth. And not only that, but then Muharram was also decided because Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu said that when people go for Hajj in the month of the Hijjah, and as we know, the hadith of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that anyone who stays away from bickering and many other things, then raja'aka yawmin waladaku, they return as if they are a brand new, I mean, they are a new baby. They are completely sinless. Their slate is absolutely clean. And this is a fresh new start. And Umar ibn Khattab is thinking that, you know, this is a fresh new start. Hence, Muharram will be the very first month. And so for all of us, this is a fresh new start. Every year when it comes to January, we always talk about New Year resolutions. Why not talk about New Year resolutions now, inshallah? So we keep this in mind, inshallah, and we progress. And we make goals for ourselves, and then we try to achieve those goals. Amin Rabbil Alameen. Jazakumullah khair.
Zakallah khair. So a reminder for new Hijri year resolutions, every single day, week, month, we should always strive to raise the bar. Mashaykh, mashallah, so all of you, mashallah, not only have studied Islamic knowledge and trained, but also, mashallah, you have experience with communities. And you know, as I was coming up here literally an hour ago, I was on a WhatsApp group and somebody texted, is it actually, you know, the first tomorrow or not? Because today is the 29th. Of Dhul Hijjah. And so the question came up, well, which madhab or which position do you want to follow in terms of figuring out? Because in terms of calculations, in terms of what is put in the calendars, tomorrow is indeed the first. But in terms of, you know, watching the moon or seeing where it's been sighted, so obviously some countries have sighted it, some countries have not sighted it. And obviously, since we're the beginning at the new year, and we're wondering about this issue, and all of us, alhamdulillah, as I said, not only have we studied, but also there's an element of being involved with the communities. I wanted to also move on to a very important conversation, which is, let's talk about this calendar issue. Let's have a frank conversation amongst ourselves, the pros and cons of what needs to be done. And let me set up by just very briefly mentioning that, subhanAllah, I myself, every single year of my life have had to face this issue since Houston growing up, early 90s, New Haven as the religious person over there, Memphis over here in Dallas as well. And I myself can tell you very honestly that when I was studying in Medina, looking at the theoretical position about what we should do, I remember I did a very in-depth study of the various positions of the ulama. And at that time, late 90s when I was in Medina, I felt that the strongest position was that we should go with, at that time, local visual sighting. That was the position I adopted, reading the books. But as I got involved with the Houston community, and especially the fitan and the problems, and then New Haven, and then Memphis, and then, of course, every single year, something happening. Over the years, I came to realize the principle that we're all aware of as students of knowledge. Everybody knows this. There's no controversy over the principle. The principle of choosing the position that might not be the strongest theoretically, but because of the context, a position that might not be the strongest becomes the strongest, right? So, of course, the position is al-akhdu bil-qawl al-marjuh. The qawl al-marjuh, the lesser position becomes the qawl al-rajih, not because of the strength of the text, but because of the context that a person is in. And a lot of people think that if somebody does this, they're watering Islam down. And of course, we know that, no, that's not the case. In fact, there are many examples in our books of fiqh, even in modern times. In fact, this is the essence of fiqh, is when to choose a position that might not be the strongest, it becomes the strongest because of the context. And so over the last 20 years of every single year seeing what's going on, I began to realize that, you know what, my theoretically ideal position wasn't ideal in the actual reality of the world that we lived in. And many, many, many years ago, more than 10 years ago, I changed over to feeling personally that actually for the North American situation, calculations and just knowing beforehand when the month begins and ends is really better overall for the goals of the community, for the unity, for mercy, for getting rid of the bickering, for the late night drama, for the uncertainty, to maximize the number of people coming for Eid, and on and on and on. So I have been very public about my position in this regard. I'd like to ask you as well, what is your view on this issue? All of you, mashallah, are studied. All of you have experience as imams. Whoever wishes to volunteer first and just have a candid conversation about this from a fiqhi and a maqasid or Islamic goals point of view.
I just have a question before we start. So this is not going to be a Sheikh Yasser halal meat type of
discussion. No.
That was a long time ago.
I just want to make sure.
Okay, Bismillah.
Okay, since I have my microphone, I'm muted anyways. I will start with that debate probably, right? No. But I don't, with all honesty, subhanAllah, I mean, Sheikh, I share the sentiment with you in regards to how you grow up, of course, you know, different environment, different fiqh culture. And then you evolve with knowledge, subhanAllah, and you mature and you grow with that. And I remember that from that kind of confusion was in the very early time when we went studying in Medina back in the early 1990s. I'm not sure if you remember that, but there has always been two calendars, even in the school. There is Taqwim Umm al-Qura and the actual Ru'ya. Yeah, and there is the standard year calendar, which is the government calendar for the Saudi Arabia at the time. And then you still have the Ru'ya calendar. So even the mix-up of dates existed in the society, even as we were studying in Medina. And to be honest with you, it was something new to me, because obviously coming from Kuwait, as we moved to Medina to study there, we only followed the Solon calendar, the Gregorian calendar. And as a result, we didn't worry much about the Hijri calendar, because it's already basically established there. But to come to Medina and realize there are two different calendars, one is already being established throughout the whole year, which is the government basically kind of dates to keep everything on a special date. But then you have the beginning of Ramadan, you know, one day before, one day after from the actual calendar that is actually established for the whole year. So I never really understood that at the time, because we were still young and we kind of like, why this confusion? Why is this and all that stuff? Of course, realize that, subhanAllah, having a standard calendar for the entire year makes, of course, government affairs easy for people. You can't make major decisions and events based on guessing a date in the future. If this is going to be the beginning of the month or the end of the month, you can't make a party, for example, on a day, guessing if this is going to be the Eid day or the day after or this and that and so on. So that's why they had this kind of like standardized, you know, calendar where they have all the dates already been established for events. But then when it comes to the Ru'ya, they would have it differently, but then they would have the confusion of the dates. So why can't we just, you know, kind of get over with that stuff and just put one standard calendar for the whole year, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and work with it and make it, inshallah, ta'ala, based on solid calculation in that regard. So I do understand that sentiment. And many people don't realize that when it comes to ulama and fuqaha, sometimes, you know, changing their opinions and even changing their maslak, going from Shafi'i to Hanafi or Hanafi to Shafi'i, even like Imam al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, who wrote an entire book on the ulama who switched, you know, madahib in that regard. Why? Because, subhanAllah, it's a matter of knowledge. It's not a matter of convenience, like many people they think it is, or twisting, you know, the nusus and the adilla. It's really a matter of understanding the essence of knowledge and ilm. And as you mature, you become in certain age where you become the leader of the community. When we were young, we didn't have to worry much about it, really. But when you become the leader of the community and people look up to you right now, you being the head imam, the senior imam, or even you become in a higher even position in the community where people respect your statements and so on. So everybody's looking up to you. SubhanAllah, we look back, like Sheikh Omar was talking in his words about, you know, the hijrah. You look back at the very beginning, how when we were young, you were just kind of very passionate about certain cause or certain position you hold on to and so on. But then when you become a leader for the community, people, they want to have from you wisdom and hikmah. The ilm and knowledge, alhamdulillah, nowadays is available for everybody. You can check it out online. What they need from you is the position. They need to do the decision making. They need from you the leadership that makes their life, subhanAllah, easy, which is basically put the fiqh into real practice. And that's the whole purpose of fiqh. If we can't put it into practice, there's no meaning for it. And I think what you're referring to is a very important position that needs to be taken into consideration, inshallah.
Sheikh Hassan, I'm going to embarrass you a little bit by pressing one thing and also mentioning the fact that when I first heard of Sheikh Yasser Brijas in Medina, he was a legend amongst the students. And that's very difficult. I'm sorry, Sheikh Hassan, but I have to do this. It's just that because Sheikh Yasser is senior to me in age and in rank in Medina, he was years
you
ahead of me.
You keep bringing that seniority just to make yourself young.
Hey, Sheikh, I'm still, alhamdulillah. when I first heard of Sheikh Yasser Brijas, I'm like, oh, you got to meet this guy. He's the top of Kulliyat al-Sharia of the College of Sharia. MashaAllah, every single year, he would be like the number one student, which is a very big deal in Medina to be the top of the entire batch. I'm going to ask you a frank question, Sheikhana. Did you also go through what I went through of initially having the position that visual was better and then calculation? Or did you have it from the beginning, calculation? What was your evolution in this fiqh issue?
Frankly, I never even considered the calculation to be a fiqh opinion to begin with. Like I was one of those young ones who always passionate about, of course, you know, the textual evidence and the proof of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, thinking that the sunnah can only be perceived in that kind of context. But then, of course, as you mature with your knowledge and your ilm and understand and start learning the fiqh of the ulama and the akharin, and you realize, subhanAllah, I mean, it's al-amru awsa'u min dhalik. There is much space. There's so much space to negotiate and look into these fiqh opinions to take them in consideration. But the decisive moment for me, really, in terms of changing and so on, is when you become a leader of the community. Exactly. And when it comes to becoming a leader of the community, your position is not just giving fatwa. Yani, kathir min ulama wa fuqaha, they wrote books for not for fiqh, but they wrote books really for decision making. And Fuqaha al-Malikiyya, for example, al-Maqari and others, you know, they're just specific books are just laid down there for the ulama to make sure when they're affiliated with being qadi in the city or qadi in the community, the decision of the qadi, not Yasser qadi, but the decision of basically...
You're the real qadi. You're the guy who studied qada. I didn't study qada.
The decision of the qadi, which means a judge, basically, it's in our time like a legislator, basically. That's what it is. And the legislator, the one who kind of like this, see what the situation is and gave a legislation, obviously. And then because they work with Islamic State at the time, these Islamic States, of course, are Islamic entities, they had the executive power to enforce these rules. Today in our time, we don't have that executive power to say this is the one that needs to unify the community or the ummah. We don't have that official position of qadi, for example, shari, but we have the position of being an imam of the community, being, you know, the sheikh and the alim in that institute and so forth. So people have respect for you, but not necessarily that same position of an authority in the society to the level where you have an executive power, you can enforce certain opinions. So for me, when you become an imam, subhanAllah, and you see people looking up to you,
the first few years, really, it was easy to make the decision because you just stick to your opinion. But then when you come to bigger community, like, for example, here in Dallas, because when I was in El Paso, we only one masjid and one community. So it wasn't a big deal, really. But you come to Dallas, you have all these masjids, all these communities, and in one locality, subhanAllah, you have all this confusion. People saying, well, do you go with this opinion, with that opinion, this community, that community? You're going to have to make an executive decision as a leader. And then, you know what? This is hopefully, inshallah, bring ease to the mind of the people with regard to the subject of beginning of the year or the month or Ramadan or otherwise. So that's just like a preference. Become at some point, inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, to help the people find ease when it comes to the beginning of the year, Ramadan, and other months of year.
Zakallah khair, Sheikh. So this is a very, very important point that theoretically, both of us were really on the same wavelength at the beginning. But then as you become involved, you see that the Sharia allows more concessions and the community needs those concessions. And when you are young, you feel that there's only haqq and batil. This must be, the other opinion is just completely wrong. But as you pointed out, Sheikh Anan, I want to say very publicly that I consider Sheikh Yasir Burgess my senior in knowledge of the Sharia, of fiqh. He is somebody that I ask questions if I'm troubled with in fiqh issues. And again, to hear from somebody that really has studied fiqh so profoundly and deeply, this is the sentiment that I want to express, that it's really not just a question of what the evidences and texts say. There's also a lived reality. And the Sharia does not want the community to be so divided, so fractured, so much infighting, so much drama. In fact, if a position is going to eliminate that, then the Sharia would ask us to follow that position. And this is what many of us are concluding after seeing all of this, fitna going on for so many years.
I would add one last point, if you don't mind, Sheikh.
Yeah, go ahead, go ahead.
Like I said, at the beginning, when I was in a small masjid, small community, it was easy to make a decision because it was just one decision. Going to bigger masjid with has difference of opinion and so forth, or different community at different masjid, it becomes a little bit harder. That reminds me with the Muslim society. Some areas are very monolithic in terms of fiqh opinions and fiqh culture, even madhab they follow, for example. But an area, for example, like Egypt, at some point, a lot of madhahab, ruled in that area. Maliki, Shafi, Hanafi, and then other areas in the Sham as well, too, in different places, subhanAllah. So when you have multiple opinions within the same locality, which opinion should be the standard for the state? And as a result, when the hakim makes a decision by taking one particular opinion, it becomes the state decision. And that's why the ulama, they say, حكم الحاكم يرفع الخلاف. So when a political entity in this regard, have someone has an executive power in the society, make a choice or make a decision on a matter that has khilaf among the ulama, difference of opinion among the ulama, that choice, even if it's not necessarily the strongest within the local community, the strongest in terms of fiqh opinion, it still becomes now the standard opinion that needs to be followed and needs to be respected. Wallahu a'lam.
Jazakumullah khair. I'm going to show my Medina bias by moving to the other Medina panelist, Sheikh Abdullah Uduro, also a Sharia graduate. Sheikh Abdullah is younger than me and much, much more stronger than me, so I'm not going to say anything at all about anything else. Sheikh Abdullah studied in Medina, I think you can, 2000 was you accepted?
And 99.
A graduate of the College of Sharia, so he specialized in Sharia as well. Sheikh Abdullah, again, you are the Imam of ICC. You've also been the Imam for so many years. You've also seen so many issues. So again, from a purely fiqh or maqsad point of view, your frank thoughts about this issue.
I just want to touch on one, what y'all were speaking about, and Sheikh Omar, he started it when he was talking about reminiscing. The verse in Al-Imran that we hear, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says after A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem, wa'tasimu bihablillahi jami'an wa la tafarraqu, and hold firmly to the rope of Allah, being the Quran, the Sunnah, or both of them, jami'an, all of you together, and do not separate. And then he says, wadhkuru ni'matallahi alaykum, and remember the blessings of Allah upon you. If kuntum a'da'an, when you were once enemies, fa'allafa bayna qulubikum, and he brought your hearts together, Islam, then becoming Muslim. فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا, and you from that reminiscing became brothers. So, coming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لِإِعْتِصَامْ هُوَ بِذِكْرِ, yani coming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and joining as a community, جَمِيعًا, is, what was the method he gave you? Is to reminisce. It's to remember those days when you were on the brinks of hellfire. وَكُنْتُمْ عَلَى شَفَى حُفْرَةٍ. But then remember how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought your hearts together. And that's very, very important. And that is, you know, when we talk about the maqasid of the sharia, the five, or some say the six, you know, from that is the hibb ad-din, is preservation of the religion. You know, from that is hibb an-nasl, preservation of the family lineage. Because the separation of the deen can sometimes cut off the lineage, which brings me to my second point. I converted to Islam. And many of the youth have the same experiences as those that convert to Islam or revert, whatever you want to call it. Context is so important in regards to the youth and in regards to people once non-Muslim or people that were born Muslim and never practiced Islam, had doubts, you know, and had no conviction whatsoever since they were 15, 16 and they were told they have to pray. Context is so important when trying to tell them about Islam. Context is so important when understanding why, when I have a job, I cannot tell them 1 year in advance. I cannot tell them that I need my vacation on this day. This is the context we're living in. As Sheikh Yasser mentioned that, you know, certain masajid are small. So they may have more of the al-saf or the characteristics of that which was of the previous days. Therefore, having one opinion is much easier. But I remember, subhanAllah, when I went to Al-Madinah and I read the verse, when the Quran is revealed, or when the Quran is recited, فَأَنْسِتُوا, to be quiet. And there were different ara. Can you recite Surah Al-Fatiha? Can you not recite Surah Al-Fatiha? That's when I said, you know what? These opinions could come from one verse. That gives liberty to the intellect, but still within the realms and respect of the integrity of the Sharia. And that integrity is maintained with consensus of the scholars. But in this issue, particularly Fatiha behind, you know, after Fatiha is recited, can the congregant recite Fatiha silently? There's difference of opinion in that. It is not permissible for you to censure the other person because there is reputable differences of opinion. And being in America, I remember coming back, subhanAllah, every summer, it hit me one day, just as Sheikh Yasser mentioned, you know, in one masjid, you have somebody from Indonesia, somebody from Egypt, somebody from Nigeria, somebody that's from America that converts to Islam. So many different contextualizations, realizations, experiences from each one in one saf. Somebody makes wudu and they just tap their head like this. Another person says, no, your wudu is not accepted. And as my brother used to say, ain't got no wudu, ain't got no salat, right? So when you look at that, what are you going to do? There has to be some contextualization when we look at these rulings in Islam. And subhanAllah, when you look at the word text, comes from context. The text has to be appropriately applied. The medication has to be given appropriately. Even though it says you can go 80 miles an hour, that when it's raining and it's sleet, you have to know how to appropriately apply that. And that is the work of the mujtahid. So when looking at this situation, firstly, we as Muslims should understand that there is respectable differences of opinion, not amongst contemporary scholars, sahaba, scholars of the past. And with that reality, we know that it will trickle down to all of us, but how do we appropriately handle that? Yes, there are some people till this day, and we're sentimental towards that, that people are saying, God, why can't we quote unquote get it together and find out something that is universal within all of us? That may, inshallah, we hope that it happens, but due to the differences of opinion and due to our human nature, by being staunch on one opinion, being a layman and sometimes a student of knowledge, we may not reach that. So what's left for us is to act cordially based on a difference of opinion of someone that we may know, whether it's a relative, whether it's a congregant, whether it's a family member or a coworker or something like that, to learn how to understand these differences. Because fiqh, what we need to remember, one of the things that I loved about fiqh from certain instructors that I had, is that they brought the maqasid and the life and the breadth of the sharia within the opinions. It wasn't just dry. Sometimes people make fiqh seem very, okay, there are three opinions, Hanafiya, Maliki, Shafi'i. Okay, what was the sababul khilaf? What was the reason for the differences of opinion? This is where you come to, okay, why did he see it that way? And you appreciate the scholarship. And I think that's lost nowadays. We do not appreciate the effort that was made, because Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmed, Abu Thawr, you know, all of these scholars, Sufyan al-Thawri, Sufyan ibn Uyayna, this was their method of coming closer to Allah. They chose an opinion and they felt that this was the closest. When we say rajih, that which weighs heavier, doesn't mean that the other opinion is wrong. No, this one I cling to more. That one I understand how you can see that. And it's a valid opinion. But I lean towards this one because I feel this is what Allah may have wanted more than that. So it's not that your opinion is totally wrong and I censure you. No. It is, I lean more towards this. And this is how I worship Allah. That these scholars, fiqh was how they worshiped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they're telling the world, I think this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant. Knowing that the truth is only one, even in these issues, but we do not ultimately know. And that's why we have beautiful ijma', the consensus, which is impermissible to differ with. But in this particular issue, there's a well-known difference of opinion. Nowadays, how do we handle that? As the scholars mentioned, we look at the maslaha of the mujtami', al-maslaha al-jama'ah, not maslaha fardiyah. We look at that which is more beneficial to the general public. Now, the public may be our particular state, our particular city. We don't want to talk about the fiqh issues. It's more about what are the decisions that are made. It's important for us, if there's a decision in Richardson and a decision down in Valley Ranch and they're different, that we respect each other's opinion. And I'll end it with a state, but a question that Abu Ja'far, the Amir during the time of Imam Malik, he asked him, "Lo ja'alta yani qawlan wahidan," if you were to make, you know, the statement or the opinion of the Muslims just one, basically on the madhab of Imam Malik, he said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, all the companions of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spread off to different places. So let them have their ijtihad and what they chosen." So understanding that when they spread to different places, there was context. And the scholar, that's why he's a scholar, because he has the tools to apply the medicine in a way that is adequate, maintaining the confines of the Sharia. So I wanted to touch on that point because it's very, very important that we consider the context of that 9-to-5 worker or that entrepreneur when looking at these ahkam, because the Sharia came for taysir, making it easy upon his servants. Allah knows best.
It's a very, very important point. First and foremost, diversity that existed from the time of the Sahaba. There wasn't just one opinion. Secondly, the fact that even great ulama like Imam Malik, when they were offered the opportunity to unify on one opinion, they said, no, let there be diversity. And then thirdly, the importance of respecting the khilaf. And fourthly, mashallah, the point of, I really like this, that every fiqh position, you have to understand their imams, they said it because of their own context. And so we as well have our own context over here. And we also need to see if it is a khilaf that is allowed, and this is a khilaf that major ulama have been, you know, on both sides, then we should look at our context and consider which one is better for our community. Sheikh Umar, you have been an imam, mashallah, for I think almost 15, 20 years. So your thoughts as well on this issue, you have seen, so you have been in the middle of ma'arik, I'm sure, from New Orleans and other places. So share with us your views and thoughts, inshallah.
So, yeah, this is a lot of personal stuff that I'll put forth here in terms of just that experience, inshallah ta'ala, then get to the fiqh of it. In New Orleans, you know, we have the East Bank and the West Bank. And funny enough, the West Bank is primarily Palestinian. So growing up, I was confused when they say we're going to the West Bank and it was all Palestinians. You know, Sheikh Yasser Bridjas's people, Salouda, where my wife is also from, it's like Silwadi Central there. So it was, we're headed to the West Bank. And, you know, my primary concern, I was in a community, the largest masjid in the East Bank. So it was the largest masjid in New Orleans as a whole. And, you know, that was staunchly upon local moonsighting, which I believe is the strongest opinion, Ikhtilaf al-Matala. And we, at the same time, wanted to find a way to unite with the West Bank as much as possible. And so it was a very long, you know, stretch there where we were trying to find a middle ground. And ultimately, you know, it did end up just resulting in mutual respect and finding ways to unite through the Eid picnic and things of that sort, because we just could not agree upon an opinion together, right? There was an insistence on both sides on the opinion. When I moved to Dallas, I initially moved to Richardson. And Richardson, of course, the oldest, Masjid al-Islam is the oldest masjid, one of the oldest masjids, is IENT. And IENT, was one of the first masjids in America, I believe, to adopt calculations because Dr. Yusuf Kavakshi, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect him. Of course, he moved back to Turkey. Was on the fiqh council and adopted that position of calculations. And I was asked to do the Eid prayer when I moved to Richardson in 2012. And it was on calculations. And in my heart, I was like, yeah, Allah, I hope that the moon sighting falls on the same day because I don't feel comfortable even doing the Eid Salah if the calculations don't match the moon sighting. So that's how conflicted I was at that time when I first moved here. So I want to start with just saying, and I hope I'm not too long-winded, so Sheikh Yasser, if you need to cut me off, you can cut me off, inshallah. But just by saying that, it should be very clear to the musalli, to the person who goes to the masjid, to the person who prays and is regular in a community, you are not tasked with figuring out when Ramadan and Eid start, period. It is from an ahkam al-sultaniyah, it is a position that is to be taken by the authority. In this situation where we live in these lands, that's our masajid, our imams, and inshallah ta'ala, you will be protected, you'll be safe, and you will be rewarded for following along with the community. You are not burdened with that. You can disagree strongly with the position that a masjid takes, but at the same time, you are not tasked with choosing that position, and you are not sinful if you go with the position, even if the day turns out to be wrong, right? Now, what does it mean for us as communities? And I want us to think of it in a few ways. Number one, it's important for the position to be coherent. Coherent. I have serious questions about how all methods have been practiced and implemented. And I think a lot of the frustration that people have had is because of the implementation of the methods, not the asl of the opinion. So for example, on global moon sighting, what happens when Saudiya does not announce, but then Yemen announces? What happens when Saudiya doesn't announce, but then Somalia announces? What happens if it's not seen in Saudi, but then someone sees it in South America, right? And I'll respect, by the way, and I respect all of the ulama, but you know, Sheikh Waleed al-Manisi, for example, in Minnesota is very consistent, mashallah, on this opinion, right? You know, in terms of his application of global moon sighting. Not to say that other scholars are not consistent, but to say that I respect that Sheikh Waleed al-Manisi has always tried to be, for example, consistent to the opinion, true to the opinion. And I think we have to have a lot of questions about how these opinions are applied and whether or not they are coherent and they are being applied in the best way possible to where the desired results can come out of that opinion. And so I'll give you my hope, inshallah ta'ala. I've always been, even as I practiced moon sighting, I've always hoped that ideally, logically speaking, if South America is included in the moon sighting and calculations are supposed to calculate the soonest time, the earliest time in which the moon can be seen on Earth, those opinions should line up almost always because South America is supposed to see the moon first. And so I have more questions about how we're applying the local moon sighting, what we're considering the matla, and then whether or not the calculations are correct, what's the criteria towards the calculations. Then lastly, I think after that, inshallah, so it's coherence, consistency, and the collective. The Prophet ﷺ said, your siyam is yawma tasumun, the day that you fast. Your Eid is the day that your fitr is the day that you do fitr. Your adha is the day that you slaughter altogether. If we can get as much of a collective, inshallah ta'ala, around an opinion that is applied with coherence, even if it's not the strongest opinion or the one that I feel most at comfort with. And Sheikh Hatim al-Hajj actually is one of those people, Dr. Hatim, may Allah preserve him, who of course gives his fatwa from Amja, but at the same time, changed his opinion, not to say that calculations is his favorite opinion, but to say that if the community will unite on calculations, that the people should go with that. And that was something, I hope I'm not misquoting him, but I know that Dr. Hatim had written something to that effect in the last couple of years. Let's find the coherence of those methods, inshallah ta'ala. Let's form the broadest collective possible around those. And let's not, you know, we should not pretend that, or we should not allow for people who don't follow this opinion or that opinion to be deemed regressive or not enlightened or not jumping on board. The goal is to unite the hearts and the goal is to bring as many people together. And so if this masjid is going with global moon sighting, even if they have issues with criteria, and this masjid is going with calculations and they have issues with criteria, I should not pretend that that scholar is regressive and backwards, and why is this person not doing that? Not everything is going to work for every community. But what can bring together as many masajid as possible and be coherent, convenient, consistent, bring the collective, that is, inshallah ta'ala, I hope there will be barakah and success in that. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to come together. And my hope, inshallah, is that if the moon sighting is allowing South America and the calculations are more accurate, then inshallah, those positions will line up almost always anyway, inshallah ta'ala. And, you know, we'll be able to keep our community together as much as possible.
Inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Jazakumullah khair. Imam Nadeem, subhanAllah, I want to ask you as well a very, very frank question. I know that, you know, before, you know, some years ago that our own masjid was on calculations. I think when you joined, it was on calculations. And then it changed over to visual. And then now we have changed over to back to the calculations. So I want to ask you, like, what, when I first came, actually, even before I came, I remember when I met you at somebody's house, we were talking about this issue. And by the way, for the viewers here, I can assure you, every single community leader and imam, this is an issue that troubles us. It's not a trivial thing. Please understand, this is something we understand. We have to answer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the decision we make. It's not a trivial thing. Don't think that we're doing this out of haste. No. I myself struggle with this position for not years, for decades. I'm going back to early 90s when I was a teenager, when I was involved with the Islamic Society of Greater Houston, and then my Medina years. And it's not an easy thing. And by the way, before I hand it over to Sheikh Omar, I wanted to add to your point that just like we don't accuse one side of being regressive or backward, also we should not accuse the other side of abandoning the sunnah. Both sides want to follow the sunnah. And both sides think that the position that they're doing is more meritorious and rewarding in the eyes of Allah and in accordance with the Sharia. Neither side is insincere. Neither side wants to abandon the sunnah. A'udhu billah, a'udhu billah. I have full confidence that those who are passionate about local, passionate about global, and passionate about calculations, all of them, inshallah, are equally sincere. And I have full confidence that all of them have ulama that they look up to. So we should unite at least in terms of our brotherhood. But Imam Nadeem, I went into my tangent. Imam Nadeem, I want to ask you, like, I know this has been something you have been wondering and questioning, because I remember the first time I met you, you actually brought up this question and you were bouncing ideas off of me. You were the one who brought it up, not me, about the views of calculation and moonsighting. Remember that conversation that brother's house we had, right? So I know you've been thinking about this. So let's hear it from you directly. Like, did you as well go through various phases like all of us on this call or what? So what is your summary as well in this regard?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاه والسلام على رسول محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد. So Sheikh Yasser, as you were saying that when you were 1920, actually I remember when I was 7, 8, 10 years old, I grew up in Arlington, and there it was just, you know, just watching how people would behave, how people would react in the masjid. I grew up here in Dallas all my life, and I just, it, you know, as a child, first of all, it got me thinking that why is there so much bickering? Why is there so much fighting? And we would always, of course, look up to our adults. We would always look up to our parents. And we would, you know, we would think that they would know how to make decisions in a rational way. Every year, Ramadan came, Eid al-Adha came, or any, you know, it was just, I mean, it was shocking to me, wallahi, that how people would behave in these kind of circumstances. Of course, after studying overseas and abroad, studying Sharia, you know, of course, I began to understand a lot of things. And, you know, subhanAllah, it got me thinking, you know, first of all, is that, you know, as you mentioned earlier, that there are opinions, even Sheikh Omar had mentioned that there are different opinions and so forth. I always go back to the one quote of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that when he talked about the Kaaba in itself, and he told Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha that were it not for your people and the fact that they just came into the fold of Islam, I would have changed the structure of the Kaaba. And this example is very, first of all, very, very profound in itself, because here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he understands that, you know, he could change the Kaaba, and that's something that he wants to do. But he understands that as being a leader of the community, where is the maslaha for the people?
where, in which opinion or in which decision is there more maslaha? And I think that today, you know, you're right, Sheikh Yasser, that when I first joined EPIC back in 2012, I think it was a year or two, we went to the calculations. Then we actually switched over to Global Moonsighting. And, you know, I then met you at this particular event. And, you know, it got me thinking, because I've been thinking about this for some time now, that in any criteria that you look at, there's always some holes, there are always some issues and so forth. And last year actually got me thinking a lot, because of this whole situation when Ramadan, or this last Ramadan when it finished and so forth, that, you know, one country said that they saw it, and then a lot of people said that, no, they did not see it. And I realized that there's so many holes in each criteria. And of course, I was thinking about this, and I realized that it's not about me anymore. You know, that's, I think that's something that all imams, I wish that we could understand, that it's not about me. It's not about my view. It's more about our community. Allah has put us in positions to serve our community. Allah has put us in positions to make decisions that will make life easier for our community. And if there is a code, if there is a code, if there is an opinion that does not contradict our Sharia and is part of our Sharia, it's not something that has just come up now. It has been a discussion amongst the ulama of the past, because what people are thinking today is that this is just something that few ulama today have concocted and they have brought together, and there is no basis of this, there is no asal of this. No, there is asal for this. And so I think when we start thinking more about the community, what's going to benefit the community at large? What's going to, you know, bring down that confusion? And I remember I called you, Sheikh Yasser. I remember I called you, I think it was either before Ramadan started, or it was, I think it was when beginning of Ramadan, or it may have been the ending of Ramadan, and I had called you. And once again, the reason why there was so much confusion is because you would assume that the criteria is simple, but the criteria is not that simple. And so when you look at an opinion like calculations, you know from before exactly, you know, when is Ramadan, when is Eid and so forth, you eliminate any kind of confusion from the community. And if it is a qawl, if it is an opinion, then as Sheikh Abdullah Duro was saying earlier on, which is very profound, that it's not just about different opinions. It's about, you know, applying maqasid al-shar'iyya in a lot of our decision-making. A lot of times, you know, people have studied Sharia, they have studied the different opinions, the four madhahib and so forth, but they have not studied maqasid al-shar'iyya. So I think we need to understand this as a whole picture. It's not just one aspect of a picture and then going with that. And, you know, as I think all the shuyukh here mentioned many times, that I think just being respectful overall, I think that's the most important thing, is that just being respectful. Today, unfortunately, we live in times where, you know, people will disagree. That's fine. That's absolutely fine. Disagreed amongst each other, you know, when they would travel. There were some who were fasting. There were some who were not. That's fine. Halas. It's not a problem. Instead of, you know, raising this issue and making such a big issue. And finally, I'm going to say this. You know, I think as a Muslim community, at times, just looking at the bigger picture, when we focus on some of these small, small things like this, I think we lose focus of the bigger picture. We lose focus of the bigger issues in our society. We have, wallahi, so many issues. All of your imams, there are many other imams, they will say that there are so many issues in their community. And a lot of times by focusing on these small, small things every single year and so forth, we're losing focus of the bigger issues at hand. We have a lot of challenges as Muslims in America already. It's not like these challenges are going to go away anytime. They're going to actually, you know, they're going to grow as we go on. So why not, you know, if you follow a certain opinion, khalas, it's fine. Alhamdulillah, we respect each other. And I think that putting this to rest, I think, you know, whatever opinion you follow, and then let's focus on the bigger picture overall. And, you know, whatever opinion you follow, at the end of the day, we're all imams, we all work together, and we all come up with solutions to help the Muslims in our community. And
والله أعلم. جزاكم الله خير.
جزاكم الله خير, مشايخ. We've had a very, very scintillating, interesting conversation. Mashallah, more than an hour has gone by, I know. I just want to wind it down by thanking all of you for coming and sharing your wisdoms, the spiritual and the fiqhi. And subhanAllah, again, to reiterate that there is no need for either side to think bad thoughts of the other side. This is a position that we've had it in our communities for decades, and in the tradition for millennia. We can go back to, as we said at yesterday's lecture, Imam al-Subki or Ibn Suraj or Mutarif ibn Abdul al-Shakhir from the Tabi'un. So this is not some new position. It's been there for the longest time. Agreed, there was no need to make it a majority position. But now, given the circumstance, mashallah, so many of us here have gone through the same journey, that fiqh isn't just copying and pasting from our tradition. Fiqh is to take our tradition and then see which is the position that is the most conducive to overall the community. Now, if somebody feels that the other position is better for the community, jazakumullah khair, no problem. From my side, from all of our sides, I know our hearts are, mashallah, full of nothing but respect. We know that you have chosen that position because you think it is the more pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask the same courtesy in respect. None of us has a personal benefit in choosing an opinion. In fact, we have to face backlash and criticism. In fact, we are getting ourselves into issues and troubles by choosing a position that some of us don't like. Yet I do so, and I know others are doing so, because we genuinely believe that in the long run, this is our belief, you can disagree with us, but inshallah, don't doubt our sincerity. We genuinely believe that in the long run, it is better for the unity of our community. It is better for the preservation of the iman of our children. It is better so that we can, inshallah ta'ala, eventually one day even declare this day to be a federal holiday in this entire country. We can have the day off for our children. We can make sure that people who are of weak iman, not going to pray unless they can take off, they know what day Eid is, they can come on that day. We're doing this not because we have anything personal to gain, but we genuinely believe that the ummah benefits from this decision, and we believe that the goals of the sharia allow us to choose this position, and it becomes the stronger position, not because of the theoretical evidence, but because of the practical ability. This is the position that some of us hold. If you disagree, alhamdulillah, no problem. We ask that our hearts remain united in the worship of Allah and in the love of the Messenger of Allah. To my esteemed guest, jazakumullah khair once again for coming and spending your time. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to bless each and every one of you to be leaders of knowledge and leaders of wisdom for your communities. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from all of us and forgives our sins and keeps our hearts united and all of the Muslims of this land. Jazakumullahu khair. Assalamu alaikum ورحمة الله وبركاته.
يا من أجبت دعاء نوح فانتصر وحملته في فلكك المشحون, يا من أحال النار حول خليله روحا وريحانا بقولك كون.